Welcome to the really good news, the really great news. I've never looked at the news and the media without it being bad news, really, in a lot of ways. I mean, do we expect to open the paper in the morning and it says, lasting world peace has just been announced. It's going to last forever. Is that what we're going to find? Because that would be really great news. Though, what we're going for is the really great news, which is lasting peace, lasting peace, lasting peace. And we are certainly digging into this story. I'm writing this story, you know, and reporting it, researching it, reporting it, investigative reporter for lasting peace. And it's not far away, actually, in terms of time. It's not far away. However, of course, we know right now the world, as I've said in many videos, it's not getting better, it's getting worse, it's getting more intense, it's getting more difficult. And so those of us who want lasting peace need to keep pushing, which is what we're doing here. Lovely day in California, like every day seems to be the last couple years. Ideal, and yet here we are, just working, investigating. What is lasting peace? What is lasting peace? What is lasting peace? Is there an answer? Maybe. Maybe. Now, this is how I'm seeing the situation as maybe. In terms of relating it to concepts and words, has to be left as maybe. All right. As an experience beyond words, how can you explain that? Maybe. So, very positive feeling that somehow, maybe. There'll be reason to have some motivation, a boost, a feeling like maybe situation is a really good one. Maybe. So, in a dream, I had this. Just before I was kind of dozing stage, and this big moving truck backed up suddenly to where I was, and the back of the truck opened, and I said, oh wow, okay, this is the answer. I've been praying for the answer, and I felt like this was being revealed to me, what the answer is. Okay, I looked inside the truck and it was totally empty, and first I said, well, whoa, what's this? What's going on here? But I didn't really react. This is all this discipline we do here. We may think that it's why are we doing this? Very good reason why we're not doing this. And here's the example. I didn't really react. I stayed just full stop in the now. Say, it's empty. Okay, it's empty. All right, the truck is empty. Huh, just, all right, that's what it is, full stop. Full stop in the wow, full stop in the burn, whatever consternation, okay, just, this is a shock, so practice what we do when we're shocked, right? When we're stunned. The spiritual path is all about stunning good news, shocking good news, okay. So we're used to practicing staying poised, truly poised without reactivity, super important. This is the way. This is the way. And then I said, hey, maybe emptiness is actually not a void, but total fullness. And then just that completely flipped everything around. And the whole situation suddenly says, wow. Zero is not an absence, it's a totality. without any exception. The so-called void that we're determinately afraid of because we don't think there's anything. No, there's everything there. All is there. The reason why I was seeing emptiness is because everything was there. And emptiness is how we term everything, as it were. It's empty of any lack, completely empty of lack. It's all there. And if we have a bunch of things there, how could we realize that everything is there? So then I realized this emptiness that we hear about is really complete fullness. And then I was off and running, you see. So by all means, this discipline that I'm suggesting is vital. Right now, the wow. This is stunning, very stunning. So, I was being shown the moving van has arrived for me, and here's my future. I was asking, what is my future? What is my future? And here comes this moving van, and I said, okay, this now is going to be revealed to me what my future is. It opens up, and it's empty. Completely empty. Not a speck of anything there. Totally, immaculately empty. The actual insides of the moving van were glowing white. It was like glowing white. It was like totally clean. Totally pure. Not a speck of dirt or dust, anything. And inside was completely empty. So this emptiness is being revealed, as it were, which is really the fullness. And instead of like reacting like, oh my God, I don't have a future, there's nothing there for me, this is horrible, yeah, no, it's just so used to staying poised that just by habit, you see, my mind, everything just stayed in the now, poised, non-reactive, and then that enabled this change of interpretation to take place smoothly. And I just said, yeah, okay, I get that. So the more non-reactive you become, the more you practice this, the better you're able to make these turnarounds. You'll make breakthroughs, 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 breakthroughs. So this is a huge breakthrough. So I say it's a super good news. Then I was able to sort of model being in the non-dual state, imagining being in the non-dual state, and the questions people are asking me, of course, everyone has questions. Are you enlightened? And I realized that the right answer is maybe. Are you in the non-dual state? Well, maybe. This is why Sri Ananda Mahima never said she was a guru, never said she was enlightened, never said she just, you know, nobody's guru. I'm just a little child. And people would press her constantly, what are you? Who are you? I say, it's maybe. And I saw how this is the correct response. Whereas before, I was struggling with this. Now, I'm okay with it. Because the ego wants to get you to be a determinant, you see. In freedom, you're not determinant. You cannot say, I am a guru, or I am this. I am. So when they say, are you this? I say, well, maybe. You're not saying yes and not no, because it's indeterminate. You're free. You're free. We're free. Without removing the motivation. Now, it's interesting, my teachers have never really said they're my teachers, maybe they are. Maybe Jesus is, maybe Longchampa is, for instance, maybe Anandamayama is. But they've never said for sure. Yes, yeah, so I've always been frustrated, like, well, come on, I need a guru, I need a real teacher. It's definitely, it's always, well, maybe we are. And this keeps the motivation going. It keeps the motivation going. Very helpful. So I'm able to look at this whole situation now much more clearly, as I'm aware progress has been made. There's no question about it over the last several months of super intense effort. The teacher is the inner teacher is the real teacher, the Holy Spirit. The inner teacher is the real teacher. That's the teacher. Now, there are examples of accepting indeterminateness. But because of the continuity fear in the ego is looking to fail. Okay? So it's looking for something so it can contrast itself and say, okay, this is failure. But we don't want to give the ego that kind of footing. We want to keep the pressure on the ego, is the whole point of the situation. We want to keep evaporating. This whole evaporative thing is where it's at. See, the ego wants you to get into specifics instead of remaining in this indeterminate situation condition. Because what we are is indeterminate. Okay, I am is total freedom, total indeterminacy, inherent greatness. Inherent freedom, inherent bliss. So the more we can get comfortable with indeterminacy, the more if we're evaporating this continuity fear. We're going towards no teaching, no teacher, no studentness. And there's a reason for that, for sure. So the ones who pick up on this indeterminacy, the maybeness of it, and they feel, wow, here's an opportunity to, it's okay to not have answers. It's okay to say, well, oh yeah, this is my guru. Well, I don't know, maybe not. I don't know, just maybe. Indeterminacy like this. They feel this consternation of the ego, the burn, full stop in that. Practicing this, this is the fast path. This is the fast path. This is the path that works. It seems like a path that it keeps going. Well, that's why it works so good. And the burn doesn't stop. The indeterminacy keeps like bugging us. Well, good. Just celebrate the indeterminacy. The complete fullness. You see, now is totally full. And we can talk of it as pure emptiness. Because all is there as an option. All options are there, without anyone having precedence, you see. There's never any preference or precedence for any option in terms of its availability. None whatsoever. Now, our preference, we choose, desire to experience various things, but as far as the ground of being and God goes, there is no preference at all. It is totally full. So the reason that you see emptiness is you're really seeing there's no preference from God. All is equally available. Right now for spirit to experience. It's limitless availability. Endless and limitless availability. With no preference from the standpoint of pure spaciousness. What is it that appears like as a cloud, as the cloud appearance and then dissolves? Is it? No preference whatsoever. So this is why you see it is totally empty. Total emptiness, as it were. Empty of preference, which means everything is there equally. everything there being there equally as an option is seen or symbolized as like this pure emptiness, spotless pure emptiness. The absence that allows all to be there. The zero dimensionality of it. So always the discipline is to remain meek, humble, repentant, confessing a severe continuity problem. Which demands a terminacy from you, and your goal is to say, no, I'm going to put up with this uproar within me, this consternation and agitation of the ego, demanding answers and determinacy, and I'm going to put up with that. I'm not going to struggle against the struggle. There's an inner struggle takes place. There is right now when I'm bringing this information to light here. There's an inner struggle. It's turmoil, shakiness, wow, really very intense. But don't struggle with the struggle is the key mantra. Don't struggle with the struggle. Full stop, no struggle with the struggle. You're aware of this turmoil, consternation. Shock, even. Okay, fine. Stay within your comfort zone, the continuity here. Same place, everything similar, similar. So all this comfort zone of continuity is here. So I just calmly just let this inner struggle settle down. This is the secret. This is the secret. If people want to know what's the secret, this is the secret. It's consistent practice in the same place, giving yourself time to ride these waves out, as it were. To go through the cycles of consternation like this, and then let them smooth out. This is the secret to the path. Which is why those who are actually feel stuck in a place and can't seem to move around at all are really the blessed ones. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek. You know, for me, I can't even imagine being able to go anywhere. It seems like those options are just dried up entirely. It's amazing, because the one thing that's so prevalent I see is people traveling, moving around, traveling, going places constantly. Look at these airplanes all going, or people are flying. I mean, and I don't feel I have the slightest possibility of going anywhere. So I just sit here in the same place, which I've done pretty much my whole life, is just pretty much sit. I used to just sit in my room for 15 years. And now I'm just sitting here, not being able to go anywhere, do anything, really. Some minimal stuff. Going to the market is like a big occasion for me. That's like, you know, wow. Going down the market, what, this is my vacation. But it's a blessing in disguise, because I'm able to sit right here. Same situation, everything's the same, right in a comfort zone, and able to look at emptiness and see it's actually everything. It's actually pure freedom. Everything, and let this sink in. You know, it's like a thunderous realization, and yet everything else is the same. So I'm so used to all this, I can allow something disruptive to come in like that and smooth it out. The comfort zone smooths it out. Whereas if you're like on the move constantly, new people, new places, trying to travel, arrange for you know, all these arrangements you need to make for transportation, for lodging, for... They're gonna let in something that's thunderously, epically, upside down changingness, like realizing the emptiness is actually perfect, total fullness. How are you gonna let that in? You know, you might see it for an instant, but boom, you know, it's like, whoops, that's too much to deal with right now. I got a ton of other stuff that I'm trying to find a comfort zone. Everything's shifting and changing constantly. So throughout history, it has certainly been that many who have succeeded have done so in a place where they just stay. Which is why householders most certainly can do this, actually. Someone who has settled down can most certainly do this. Longevity's advice is he gives some advice to, and great advice to everyone who would like to succeed at this. He says, cut out all distractions and just, you know, live in a cave and just spend your time meditating there. And don't seek to do this or do that and everything. Just forget it, let it all go and just focus. Well, it's very good advice. So there may be some of you who feel, wow, my life is nothing. I can't really do anything. I can't make a mark on the world. I'm not a mover and a shaker in the world. I cannot go into all these meetings and committees and deciding this and that. I'm just like a nobody here in this world. You are the ones that are actually fortunate, very fortunate. And you have to make the most of the situation. So I say, oh, here I am again today. I've been sitting there for 10 years, same spot. Yeah, so you feel like, home. This is home. I'm comfortable with this place. Nothing's changing. Good. So then you can allow this tidal change to take place within you. Realization. Delusion begins to, the clouds of delusion clear up. And you suddenly say, wow. This is a game changer. But you look around and say, well, but there's nothing to do about it. I can't go anywhere or do anything. I just got to sit right here. So I'm just going to sit here. The commitment to just sitting is super important. I have to emphasize all this stuff because what else is there to emphasize? You know, commitment to sitting is super important. Trumps the commitment to go out and do activity. Trumps that commitment. Now, it may seem the world is passing you by, but if that's not the case, is that you're passing the world by. That's what actually happens. It may seem the fortunate ones are the ones that are traveling all over the world and meeting all sorts of interesting people, going interesting places. Oh, look at this, look at this, look at this. All this eye candy of the world. And, you know, they may seem like out there recreating and dining and doing all sorts of cultural stuff and, you know, making money. And you think, wow, they're so fortunate and I'm so deprived of all that. Actually, what you're going towards is realization. You have everything right now, all options. Complete liberation. Something infinitely better than anything the world has to offer. but you're not likely to see this as long as you're frantically, you know, chasing after the world. Now, there may be little episodes where you may concentrate, focus, like I just concentrated on history. I've had this concentrated focus on history the last several days. And then back off of it, okay. So, you know, okay, going back over the story of Noah, and then Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The three main sons who then have lineages who end up, you know, being the ones who populate the Ham is like the Egyptian area, and Shem is the Semite Arabian Holy Land area, and then where Israel is now, Judah, Israel area, and then Japheth is more the northern seagoing people, the Hittites, the Canaanites, and then Eber is one of the offspring of them, is the Mesopotamian, which comes to the Assyrian, you know, so there's this. You sort of, become aware of the tales of history and stuff. And for some reason, the Holy Spirit had me do that in a real concentrated way, just focusing on this a bit real quickly. And it sort of helps you make, shrink it all down. Because the ego is just trying to get you to fail, for sure. And so you need to be comfortable to say maybe, and not give specific answers. And the ego is looking for knowledge or facts and details and trivia, you know, and it's like, wants you to say, well, what is the lineage here, what is the lineage there? If you really looked at the stuff and say, well, I looked at it, that really wasn't that interesting, you know. Eagles say, well, you haven't even looked at it. How do you know it's not interesting, you know? And say, so sometimes the Holy Spirit has us focus on something for a while. It's sort of fire-breaking the situation so that then that gives us some room from the ego, from the demands and pressure of the ego, actually. So you don't have to give any specific answers. Well, you know, who did this, this, that? Well, maybe they did. Maybe that's true. Maybe this Noah's story, maybe, you know, whatever. It's maybe. Don't need any specific answer. It's like saying, what caused perfection? Nothing caused perfection. But what caused the now? Nothing caused the now. We're looking for causation of what we already are, have always been. There is no causation of it. The ego is trying to determine causation, because that's the goal. What we try to do is we cause reality, not God. When we say that no causation, from the standpoint of spirit, there is no causation. From the standpoint of God, God is the causation. And we actually, God's extension as God to all means all is God. We are God. All is God. It's a total extension. God, as it were, extended itself as us, as spirit. So there's no causation at all. It's all inherent. The way things are is totally inherent. The way reality is completely inherent. There's no causation. The ego is trying to establish lineages and chain of causation. See, it's interested in chains of causation, processes and stuff. So when someone asks a question, it's partially ego and partially desire to be free ego. So you say maybe, you throw it back on them and say maybe. And then that causes the ego to be very agitated. And then that gives you the opportunity to practice full stop in the now, full stop in the wow, full stop in the burn. The opportunity to practice is there. This is the whole point of the situation. This is what the situation is all about. You go to some maybe teacher, and you're going to get maybe, a whole lot of maybe. So what the maybe teacher does is point you to right practice, actually. which is this indeterminate full stop in the now, which ultimately brings about the poise, the inner poise, to recognize, ah, this emptiness is actually total fullness. It's not a void. It's the total absence of a void. There is no void. And if there is no void, okay, then we realize that the continuity fear is the only issue there really is. Question is it better just to try to just be peaceful, force peace upon yourself, or is it better to bring up this consternation and then practice that? And what I've done is certainly bring up the consternation. What the dreams that I have bring it up. The Holy Spirit seems to be, you know, dredging this up, and then I have to work on letting this evaporate. So, from my standpoint, the continuity fear, you have to bring it up. But from the standpoint of answering, say, well, maybe it's the way. Don't make it determinate. Maybe this is the way. And that brings it up. People get obsessed about, well, should I do this or this? That's the ego. What we should do is sit quietly, and whatever arises, work on this full stopness. Neither thinking ahead, nor the past, nor to the side. Not focusing on it, but not making it, get rid of it, make it better, make it worse. It's evaporated. So you stay in this evaporative condition. Not answering. Not rushing. Not struggling with the struggle. Staying in an evaporative condition. This is how I see it. Don't focus on the upset. Don't focus away from it. Indeterminate. But what you're doing is you're staying still. Your body's still. And your mind is also still. It's like you're seeing a storm. Let's say you're in this comfortable, safe place, or right outside here it's storming, and you're just sitting there. You're not trying to stop the storm at all. You're not reacting to the storm, trying not to react. Just let it storm. After a while, all the water's fallen, the sky's clear. So what we're really doing is we're precipitating the clouds. So the rain does fall. But once the rain falls, hey, the clouds are gone. Clouds are gone. So it is, the path is like to precipitate the rain. Let it come, and say, okay, it's no problem. Now it may be pouring down, but we have a little roof. We're under this little shelter here, and it's not touching us. Of course, if we run out in the rain, it'll touch us. Then we'll say, oh, this is terrible. So don't run out in the rain. In other words, don't struggle with the struggle. The rain symbolizes this struggle, this turmoil pouring down. You are just under this little shelter, and you're just sitting there, not running out in the rain. It's a good metaphor for it. And you don't say, well, how long is this going to last? You don't ask questions like that. How much rain is going to fall? No. You're not trying to quantify the rain or the time. No quantification. You're simply making sure that you don't run out in the rain. You just sit quietly. You're You're not trying to answer the rain, give answers to it. Because all you're waiting for is the rain to finish and then realize the skies are now clear, or a lot clearer than they were before. All this rain runs off to the ocean. And the ocean is not evaporative, actually. Of course, the clouds and the rain are actually all hallucinations. But once the hallucinations are gone, the skies are all clear. That's it. And you never know what's going to trigger the upset. So don't, like, say, no, wait a minute, what's the cause of this upset? No, if it's there, it's there. Right now, there's a lot of turmoil in me. What's there is there, okay. Something is able to trigger it, that's good. So you want to have the upset triggered. You want it to rain. Not emotional upset, that's a defense system. This is overall structural shakiness that's happening. The whole structure, my conceptual structure, but the whole conceptual structure of conceptual structures is all very shaky right now, is it? And my breathing isn't really smooth. If I was trying to breathe, it'd kind of be really, you know, shaky. If I tried to, I just sort of breathe easily and don't try to seize control of this body, you know, for the purpose of something. Because I realize, you know, the nerves are shaken up. That's why you sit quietly, not doing any action. It's an overall conceptual shakeup, a shakeup at its very foundation. The whole foundations are like trembling. Once you get through this, it calms down, you will be much more confident of looking at this again more clearly and in greater depth. But don't try to do it while the rain is pouring down. See, this is very important. I think when you go to someone who can help, whether it's the inner teacher or someone else, you go to the inner teacher for help, for example. Expect to be shaken up. That's what you're there for. The whole structure of conceptuality and the whole belief system is just being shaken. It's all trembling, and it's just, nothing is certain there anymore. You know, it's like, wow, the whole structure, the uncertainty of the structure has become very plain. The mistakes. The whole thing being based on a fear of the void. Now I see there is no void. Imagine what that does to the conceptual structure. The whole belief system is based on the fear of the void. Avoiding the void. Being attracted to bodies, things. You know, and definition, specificity, preference, judgment, determinism, embracing that, keeping it. Now I realize there is no void. It's actually perfect fullness. Just imagine what that's doing to my, you know, belief system. That belief system. False belief system, belief system, and determinism. It's like the rug has been pulled out from underneath it. Practicing like this is no trouble at all. It's just like it's pouring rain. Okay, fine. It's no trouble. Just be patient. Wait till the rain stops. So you could encapsulate the spiritual path as one in which you're exchanging belief systems, and in doing so, you realize the old belief system. Is, of course, we've been basing everything upon this false belief system. And we think that false belief system is necessary for us to be, to exist. So, of course, it's you have to go about it carefully. And not act out your fears. Not become frantic or panicked. So it's like having the rug pulled out from underneath you progressively, and the instability you feel from that, for sure. So of course it's difficult. Path is difficult. There's no way around it. It's absolutely difficult. So you need to make it easy as possible. Nothing beats doing nothing. That's unbeatable. Because right now, like, my belief system has had the rug pulled out from under so bad, I don't know what my beliefs are, you know, right at this point. So how can I take a determinate course of action, so to speak, in the world right now? How can I act with authority? How can I be the executive of my life when my whole belief system is in shambles? I don't know what to believe right now. Obviously, you would feel like bewildered and lost and ineffectual. So you don't want to have to press yourself into action in situations like this. You don't want to do it. You just want to take it easy. Don't want to even think about action. Don't even think about action when you're in this situation of letting it rain, making it rain, as it were, making it rain and letting it rain. Don't think about action. Don't even think about action. What am I going to do? What am I going to do next? No. You're not going to do anything until the rain stops, and you don't know when it's going to stop. So it's indeterminate. You just say, well, it's indeterminate. What I'm going to do is indeterminate right now. Don't let the mind dwell on the future. Don't let the mind wander. So what am I going to do next? So we don't know how long it will rain, how intense the rain will be. Just let it, just stay with it, that's all. So the better you get at this, the more will be revealed from within. The more stable your practice, the more will be revealed from within automatically. Because you can handle it. You can handle it. People will say, well, is it determinate? Is it maybe? Is it indeterminate? Maybe. And this maybe to all questions like this is a profoundly effective approach. Just feeling this intense burn right now, just intense. Sort of an extreme consternation. Don't force it. Don't force it. Don't struggle with the struggle. Don't make it. Try to force it to be more. Try to force it to be less. Just trust this Holy Spirit. You just is brought up, okay? Now let the rain is coming. Let it rain for a while. Yeah, this is just colossally intense right now. I can't, you know, draw any conclusions about it. Just don't draw any conclusions. Don't draw any conclusions. Remember, you're practicing. It's commitment. Commitment to practice. Commitment to right practice. No, don't draw any conclusions. But you know, if it's raining this intense, there's a lot of clearing taking place up in the sky, right? A lot of clearing taking place. Maybe that's why I have dreams of extreme rain. Sometimes just the most incredible amount of rain where the whole landscape is just flooded and huge rivers and cascades everywhere. Maybe that's just a massive, you know, release of delusions taking place, possible. See a maybe teacher, or you could look within, maybe within. The results, oftentimes, you see the people are like, they're like under this intense consternation. They're not all bubbly and, hey, this is a nice social event or something. No, it's just like they're being almost crushed with this consternation. This is great progress for them. This is as intense as it gets right now. So far. And by doing it this way, we don't have to try. We're not trying to find some ultimate intensity to it. We're just letting all the rain come down, that's all, and when it's done, it's done. We're not thrill seekers here. We just want all the rain to come down, to get out of the sky, and the skies to be clear. So in your practice, you know, just make sure when you do this, all the basics right, you're going to get automatically, you will be able to allow something to arise that really triggers this consternation. And then you're able to then let us subside. This just hits super, super hard. But I'm just showing, even when something hits super, super hard like this, you just sit quietly like this and let it rain. It does feel like the whole nervous system has been, put under some kind of pressure. Of course, because our expectations are suddenly being suspended, as it were. It's all just maybe. It's all indeterminate. So this really is great news. To get to this and be able to handle it like this, is just allow it like this, is really great news, actually. It's a breakthrough. Pulling the rug out from underneath yourself is a great breakthrough. Normally we're too frightened to do that. But here's some advice. Don't ever just wait thinking that your lucky day will come. The stars will be aligned at some point and it'll be easy. Don't wait for that. The Christians have an interesting way of pressuring themselves saying, Jesus is coming back, nobody knows when. It could be today. So you better work on it today. In other words, this realization could be today. Pressure's on. Indeterminacy is on. So if you're saying, oh no, it's certainly going to happen, and the stars will align in 20 years and everything will be fine. No, put the pressure on today. It's all indeterminate. Maybe it will, maybe it won't, it's all indeterminate. Put the pressure on right now. I'm getting the intense burn in the sinus cavities, and it often shows up there just to feel like you're going to sneeze. I said, no, I'm just going to let the burn happen there. You can tell if you're doing it right if you don't sneeze. This is one of the ways I can tell I'm really locked in. A lot of itches will happen around the nose and the sinus and your face, and you won't feel like, keep your hands off your face. This is another practical advice here I'm giving, to sort of some general practical advice. Keep your hands off your face, out of your hair, off your face. Don't be scratching anything. Here comes another intense itch in the noses. basically, I just keep my hands like this. Just keep your hands together. I know some meditation things are like this. And Buddha's like maybe like this. And Amida Buddha is like such and such one. And different mudras and stuff. But I just basically, you know, just keep the hands together like this. Just rest the hands together. If I'm talking, sometimes I'll go like this. The hands just rest them together. Don't touch your body with the hands. You see people who are trying to meditate, all sorts of distractions will arise for them. It's limitless, isn't it? Well, I have this sinus problem. I have this nerve thing. All these things are acting out resistance, acting out. Just say no. I'm just going to full stop in the now. Continue this full stop in the now. And it's a battle of will. Have to apply your will. Each little victory you get more confident. It's a matter of stringing together all these victories, as it were, just building this treasury of victories over with your will, saying, "No, I'm going to continue." Overcoming these resistances and just let full stop. So, if you go to like a satsang, it should be, you know, 2 to 3, 4 hours or something. Where it gives you the opportunity to really go through the ordeal. It's an ordeal. You should realize it is an ordeal. It calls upon all your will. It's like, what do you call, a challenge for you. You're challenging yourself. You're saying, I don't want to waste my life without being truly challenged. I really want to put myself through the challenge, and I want to do everything I can to meet this challenge. And so you really use your will, your determination. Another way, put your hands, you just nest them, one and another like that, just nest them. I don't even pay attention. You keep your hands. Don't touch the body with the hands. Something's itching here. That don't touch the body with the hands. Don't move the feet, really. Don't be nervously moving the feet. Keep the feet calm and still. Without trying to freeze anything up physically. Don't, that's trying to cheat yourself. You're not trying to freeze anything up, lock yourself up or anything, no. You're still functional, good still, but you're just sitting quietly. Say in meditation, a great meditation practice is to say, I don't know, I don't know. I don't know, try that, I don't know. I better not try too many of these because I'm already totally spiritually buzzed here with the pressure of maybe. Now, someone who's really gone finished with this, maybe finished, you see, they can trigger, everyone who comes up to them, they can trigger. It doesn't, see, they don't get, there's no problem for them anymore. All the rain is gone. So they can just go around triggering everybody they meet, and it's no problem for them. But like for me, I, I can't say too much more because I'm already just, you know, the rain is just like deluge. It's a deluge right now. And it's interesting, I'm studying Noah, which of course is antediluvian, before the deluge, like antipasta, before the pasta, before the deluge, antediluvian patriarch, living to be 900 and what, Noah's 80, 60 some years, a lot. Then there's this terrible, huge deluge, and all the water comes down into the earth. Apparently it was all up in the atmosphere before, most of it. Whatever. But the symbology is interesting. It was a deluge. So right now I'm experiencing this deluge. Rain down, rain down, rain down your love on your people. Well, this rain is the conceptual judgmental structure of the ego is all disintegrating, like clouds disintegrate into rain. Okay, so it's like an inner rain that is happening here. Problem that people have is they want to finish fast. They want to be enlightened. They want to be the guru, the teacher. So they push too hard and overwhelms them. Remember, don't struggle with the struggle. They say, I want to get it done. Well, I got a couple months. I want to be enlightened in a couple months. See, that's the problem. That's making it very determinative. You have to say, I don't know when this is going to be finished. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe today, maybe not today. It has to be an everyday thing. Everyday thing. Everyday situation. It doesn't have to be, but it's preferable to keep the momentum going. The great teachers will tell you, we must keep the momentum going. Your path must be brisk. It must be intense. Don't get out of spiritual shape. Once you get in shape, don't get out of shape. Very difficult to get back in shape. So it's very good if there are no demands on you. So I often do it in the evening time. This is a weekend, Sunday morning. All right. No demands. So it's very important to have one day of a week set aside where there's no demands on you. This is a day of prayer once a week. Very important. This is something our society has really gotten away from. And there should be also every day in the evening, there should be set aside some time. There's no demands on you. Very important. Sure, go to work, be busy during the day, okay. That's understandable. But don't bring the work home with you. This excessive homework for children is terrible. Children should have, in the evening time, they should have like ability to have quiet time where it's not demanded that they are able to start meditating, really, and praying. Get right habits going. Especially don't watch television in the evening or movies or anything like that, for sure. This is your time, you see, to let it rain. No demands on you. So the evenings, and then one day set aside for an intensive. There should be an intensive every week. So make Sunday your intensive. This is how it should be. During the daytime, you should, Jesus says, every hour, give a little 5-minute intensive during the day, which I sometimes lapse on, but that's because I'm doing the intensive all day, no matter what I'm doing. I'm at it very intense, but it's a very good idea, 5 minutes an hour, of just bring to mind, you know, maybe, I don't know, some little mantra, some little affirmation, I don't know. Maybe, just maybe. So a religious culture is all important, meaning your culture, your society allows you this, reinforce it, insists that this is okay for you. Sunday, or whatever the Sabbath day, nobody's working. Not partying or festivals or all this kind. You know, this is your quiet day. You stay at home. You're not supposed to do any work on Sunday. Housework, yard work, any kind of work. Day for prayer. Now, of course, maybe your house won't be so splendid as the pagans who are working every single day of the week with many servants and helpers and never stopping. But you're stopping. So you'll be humble, meek, see, simple. But you are generating right habits. And there's nothing more valuable than the right good habits. Would you rather have $1 billion or a tremendous amount of really great habits? So that's the question, right? Very good question. So what I've done is I've not spent my time making money. I spent my time developing good habits. Now, people will say, well, how do good habits get you money? Well, I guess I'm going to find out. I don't know. Just keep on working on good habits. Now, when you're driving, you can practice, as I said. Don't be looking at people. I don't look in other cars at people. I don't look at people walking along the street. I'm just driving, just focusing on safe driving. That's it. It's a very good meditation. Actually, driving can be a very helpful meditation. Holy cow, especially where I live. It's like intensely difficult. With the aggression of this area now, and then super congestion, and everybody at high stress level, everybody in a hurry, everybody late, everybody trying to get the slightest advantage they can over you, driving wise. You know, it's an intense exercise, actually, of keeping your cool, letting people in, understand the situation, you know, helping others. You gotta be helpful to others, because everybody is just like stuck. You know, it's almost like it's almost virtual gridlock everywhere in the Bay Area. And you see people that come out of a parking lot or something, and you realize they're gonna be stuck for 10 minutes here or something if I don't let them in. You know, and I'm already stuck here pretty much, so I said, you know, come on in. And they said, thank you. And actually, I did that just recently. And then someone else wanted to come in down the road, and they were stuck too. And the car that I let in, they stopped and let them in. That's called good karma. That's called, you see, setting a good example. They thought, hey, he let me in. I'm going to let this person in. So you almost have to have a culture of kindness, you know. Otherwise, it's going to deteriorate into vicious sculpture, and it already is to a large extent because all these people that got on turnoffs where it's backed up, super congested, backed up, they'll just zoom right to the last point where the turnoff is, you can't turn off anymore, there's no more, and then they'll just jam their way into the front of the line, just unconsciously. They don't care. They're just, they force their car in, you know, so either you let me in or we're gonna have an accident. And also, the ones that are missing their turnoff, they're going 85 miles an hour and suddenly realize the turnoff, oh, it was right there, I missed it. Whew, you know, just like whip, turn, severe right turn, go across the median. I mean, it happens all the time. And you're driving and suddenly they cut right in front of you and you gotta hit the brakes or something. It happens all the time that people missing their exit and they just drive extremely recklessly to make that turn off as if the five extra minutes that it takes to go to the next exit, turn around, come back and get off, 5 extra minutes maybe, is gonna ruin their lives. This is the attitude in this Silicon Valley. I can't afford 5 minutes for my life or your life. This 5 extra minutes is going to make the difference in my life. This is the pressure that these high-tech companies have everybody under. This insane pressure. It's a pressure cooker. Now for me, I say, oh, 5 minutes, that's okay. A little more time to meditate here, a little more time to keep my attention focused. I was driving home. I think I said, told this on the driving home, and I was calm. No hurry, and I was going to make a right turn on after traffic had cleared, and I decided, well, let's not be real aggressive here. Let's just wait until it's obviously really clear, and let's keep it, you know, easy. I don't want to pull in front and have to accelerate too fast. And lo and behold, this car with no lights came and zoomed past me, and I never saw it, you know. So I just said, well, you know, okay, it's an extra 30 seconds here is not a problem. Extra 30 seconds is not a problem. So it's almost required here, so you don't get in accidents and road rage and everything. I mean, this area is, I experienced this. Someone had road rage towards me up in Marin County. I'd never been to this place before. I didn't know the road. And there was this turn, this exit, and I was completely unaware of. And so I did have to get in or something like that, yeah. And someone just got absolutely furious at me, you know. They were totally caffeinated and just, or on cocaine or something, you can just feel the intense franticness of the area. Wow, I've never gone back, you know. Never gone back to Marin County, really, try not to. You get this feeling of severe entitlement there and get out of my way, what are you doing in my way? So I do let people in, you know, if somebody, I can tell, so you sort of feel if somebody, you can see the situation they're in, and say maybe they're not from this area, a lot of new people come in here. So they're you know, somebody is in a bad situation, help them out, absolutely. And even if they're just trying to take advantage of you, don't you lose your calm and peace over that. They want to, if 5 minutes is so important to them, fine. Because I know I'm continuously working on what I need to work on. That's okay. It's not stopping my sadhana, my practice, my prayer, contemplation. But I'll tell you what, I would sure would like to be in some place where the roads were wide open, wide, spacious. Just a few cars. Oh man, the stress levels go down hugely. Why there's just not so many cars here. I'm afraid to leave my house almost. You do get this what they call it, agoraphobia or some fear of leaving your house. I don't have that, but I can understand those who do for sure. Like 8 o'clock in the morning, I don't want to go out there because it's gridlock. All the kids are going to school. Everyone's mother or dad in some cases is driving them, the kids, to school. All, you know, it, and you, you know, it takes you 20 minutes to get on the freeway where it should take 5 at the most. And it's, you're missing all the lights. You barely move from the lights, and it's, and, you know, it's just like you begin the battle with the day. And you know, you, who wants to battle with the day? Who wants to have cars coming at you from all directions, constantly pressuring you? Come on, go faster. They get on your tailgate, go faster. Everybody's speeding, you know. I don't want to get a ticket. I think people here, I mean, just yesterday, this is driving, light turns orange. I'm far away from the intersection. Light turns orange, no brainer. Slow down, turns red. And I see the car on my right, from behind me, just go right through. Totally ran the red light on purpose. I'm not stopping for this red light. It just happens all the time. I can't afford to get a ticket, you know. And these people, I think they can afford to get tickets or whatever. I don't know what their mentality is, their entitlement mentality is. They feel like, oh, I can run a red light. That's okay. You know, I'm important, so it's okay. I can run any red light I want to. If you're going, you know, 40 in a 35, say, wow, this is too fast. They're right on your tail saying, get out of my way. I want to go 45. This is how it is here. It's an entitlement place here in the Bay Area. Most people here feel super entitled, you know, to get what they want. Almost all, you know, all of them, almost all of them are professionals, highly educated, which really builds up this entitlement mentality. So I have to deal with that. I'm getting a little bit of work now, and I need to get back on the road. Holy cow. Nobody's cutting you any slack. There's no slack. There's no slack there to be cut. There's nowhere to go. You have to plan ahead where you're going to get in the right lane, because it's all the lanes are clogged. Cars everywhere. You've got to, you know, really know your route and get in the right lanes ahead of time. So the aggression is off the charts here. Controlled aggression is the vibe of the Silicon Valley. Controlled aggression. So I just channel that into, hey, get into this ordeal here. Otherwise, you know, this is going to go on forever. Don't want that to go on forever, so I better keep doing this and succeed at this. I don't want to be trapped here forever in this place. I've been trapped here my whole life, and trapped is the right word for it, actually. But certainly you don't want to drive also in this intense situation when you're doing this practicing. So that's why I do it in the evening when I know I'm not going out. Or Sunday, I know I'm not going out. Or the weekend, pulled away from this. And you're not going to be aware that you can smooth it out. You're not going to be aware. The important thing is, it is to be aware that, yeah, it does smooth out. How you gain the confidence, it does smooth out. Certainly, you put your phone on silent or vibrate or something. Don't answer your phone if you can help it. You know, if you do, just put on pause real quick. Okay, off again. You're not tweeting anybody. You're not on social media. You're not doing anything with your phone. This may become extremely difficult for younger people. It's like they're married to their phone. The phone is actually just using them. It's demanding that they pay attention to it. You have to realize this controlled aggression in the Silicon Valley is pouring through every smartphone in the world and demanding that you pay attention, that your attention be on that phone, demanding it. And they're very good at controlled aggression. They're very clever at it. But it is extremely aggressive. Make no mistake, it is extremely aggressive. The drivers here are extremely aggressive. But it's controlled. So you can't quite, you know, get angry at them so much. But there's this entitlement, controlled aggression, and that is what's pouring through all your gadgets, all your smartphones. All of this is saying, you must pay attention to this, you must look at this, you must do this, you must be involved in this, you must. Demand. See, this is a huge problem in the world, which I've warned everybody about, been very adamant about. Stay away from smartphones. Stay away from anything that is gobbling up your attention like that. I used to have an old flip phone. Only thing I use it for is just call someone quickly, okay, boom, that's it. Occasionally, text. I guess people are texting so much now they don't even call, so. Say, hey, Giants won, that's it. So it's super minimal use of technology. And then this simple camera here. That's it. Try to keep the whole use of technology super minimal. Stay away, because I'm telling you the mindset of these people, having lived with them my whole life in this area. They're super aggressive, controlled aggression, very shrewd. Very demanding of your attention. Very much feeling they're entitled to your attention. They feel they're entitled to your attention. Okay. You have to say, I'll put my attention where I want to put my attention. Which is on the spiritual path. And the problem is this mindset here has flooded the world like a deluge. And so many people are jumping on board. These super aggressive people have been pulled into this whole industry because it promises control. They can demand what your attention is going to be. So they think that they can get your attention on them doing what they want you to do. And they think that'll result in their happiness. Because it will keep their attention away from spiritual path, which they're frightened of. They're frightened of the void. They think there's a void there. They're frightened of the continuity fear. So if everybody's putting their attention on them, they say, hey, I can't do it because everyone's demanding that I keep producing stuff for their attention. You know, it's a trap. They're setting themselves up in a trap. So really these tech people are trapped. They're in this trap. They might not realize it, but they are. So the best thing you can do for them is don't give them any attention. Even though they're demanding it, don't give them any attention. And that will be very helpful for them in the long run. Because out of this continuity fear and the fear of the void, we build up all these defenses. And the thing is, maybe we want to drop this defenses, but the defenses are still functioning. And so we feel like we're trapped. If everyone's putting their attention on you, you feel you have to act accordingly. And you can't just say, you know what, I'm just going to meditate for the rest of my life and goodbye. No, you're our idol, you know, you're, we have to put our attention, if you're not there, then we can't put our attention anywhere, we'll fall into the void. So you have to keep functioning to save us from the void, you see. Is this mutual dependency sort of thing that develops between idols and idolaters, and the idol gets very badly trapped in that. So the best thing, the way to help people is don't give them any attention. Don't give attention to people, so to speak. Give your attention to the path, to the discipline. That's where your attention belongs. This full stopness, as we've done in this video. Whew, I'm starting to feel a little bit relief from the rain here. That was just ultra intense. The effects are still there. Give your attention to the path. To every evening, no distractions. Once a week, like Sunday, whole day, no distractions. Keep your social life simple, your relationships simple. Give space to others, let them give space to you. Insist they give space to you. You give them space. And everybody benefits from this. Everyone benefits from this. You say, I won't give you attention, you don't give me attention. Great. Let's put our attention on this discipline here, this ordeal. Spiritual path is an ordeal. Being a pilgrim is an ordeal. It requires your attention. Because we're dealing here with the basically the disintegration of a belief system, the exchanging of it, but it's also feels like a disintegration. We start shaking and we say, hey, this is shaky. Let me shake it some more. This is really shaky. Maybe we can come get this come down. Oh, it's starting to disintegrate. Oh, wow. This is, it's intense. It's an ordeal. This requires your full attention. Full stop. In other words, full attention here on what's taking place. Full attention on realizing this is a systemic shakeup. This is a systemic disintegration. This is the whole situation. This is, don't try to isolate. Just realize, full stop on the now. I mean, don't isolate, don't define, don't judge this or that. It's a systemic, holistic, total shakeup takes place on the path. You realize this entire belief system is false. There's no truth to it whatsoever. This requires your full attention. Full attention. You can't be out there having fun and doing this and that. This being a pilgrim requires your full attention. If your life's going to be a pilgrimage, it requires your full attention. And of course it's a struggle because so many idols are in the world of saying, look at me, give me attention. Just distract yourself. So if you're giving attention to anyone, it needs to be adamant non-dual advice, adamant non-dual practice, the ordeal, the challenge, the ordeal, the maybe-ness, the I don't know-ness, the indeterminateness. Practice. That's where you need your attention needs to be. And ultimately, your attention needs to be on your comfort zone, your practice, the inner teacher. And automatically, these insights will arise. They may arise in dreams first, and then they spill over, and then, wow, the disintegration of a false belief system is underway. The rain is falling very strongly. very intense. And this, again, is just giving a showing, helping, encouraging. Put your full attention on your path as much as possible. All right, that's it.